I think the human race needs to think more about killing. How much evil must we do in order to do good? The conventional wisdom is don't make the same mistake twice. Learn from your mistakes. We saw Vietnam as an element of the Cold War, not what they saw it as, a civil war. We were wrong.
Being the son of Robert S. McNamara, who is thought of as the architect of the Vietnam War, has been challenging all my life. As a young teenager, 13, 14, 15, as I was beginning to understand the conflict and the atrocities and the fact that the war was wrong, I have, through my adult life, grown up with that. And I think have been grappling with, in essence, truth, honesty, and lies. And have asked my father in his passing, in his death, why he couldn't have been honest. Why he lied to me as his son, to his wife, I assume, and to our nation, and certainly to the men and women who fought in Vietnam and to the Vietnamese.
My family and I left Vietnam when I was 5 months old on April 29th, 1975. We were living in the refugee camp for several months, not knowing if our loved ones who weren't with us had escaped or had been killed by enemy forces or possibly perished out in the open water. So we didn't know for a very long time. And it was really a very difficult time for my family because on top of worrying for those loved ones who weren't with us, we also didn't know what the future would hold in this new country. And so desperately wanting to be back in the homeland, but knowing that of course, the country, Republic of Vietnam, was lost to us.
A time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to reap, a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to laugh, a time.
I don't think we're going to learn a lot from Vietnam, that we're not going to do it again, except we hope that that kind of situation doesn't come up. But I have little hope that Americans learn much from history.
I want to end this war. The American people want to end this war. The people of South Vietnam want to end this war. But we want to end it permanently, so that the younger brothers of our soldiers in Vietnam will not have to fight in the future in another Vietnam someplace else in the world.
I don't believe that our leaders have genuinely learned the lesson of Vietnam.
On my orders, the United States military has begun strikes against Al-Qaeda terrorist training camps and military installations of the Taliban regime in Afghanistan.
Did you?
As an adult, especially when I read of refugee stories coming from the Middle East as well as Central Asia and America's wars abroad, I mean, it definitely brings back memories of what Vietnamese had gone through in the 70s. And of course, more recently with the fall of Kabul and the fall of Afghanistan, that, you know, there was an outpouring of Vietnamese American support for these refugees because it brought back memories of 1975. And so you know, the stories are universal, the pain, the suffering. You know, when the Americans leave, the war isn't over, and it doesn't end with the last shots fired. It continues on with these, you know, these refugee stories.
So when I saw people fleeing from Kabul, for me, it was like a flashback of my experience when I was fleeing, my family were fleeing Vietnam. It was chaotic, and for us, and also we were very scared because we did not know if we could get out of the country. So the unknown and the panicking and everyone else trying to flee at the same time, like I said, it's utterly chaotic. And for us, when I saw that, I felt like I was back in Vietnam in 1975.
Every American president has offered support to the people of South Vietnam. We have helped to build, and we have helped to defend.
The first time the Americans came, the children followed them. They gave the children sweets to eat, then they smiled and left. The second time they came, we poured them water to drink. The third time, they killed everyone. Killed everybody, destroyed everything. Nothing was left.
Well, the Oriental doesn't put the same high price on life as does the Westerner. Life is plentiful, life is cheap in the Orient.
My house burnt down while I was away. The lives of my countrymen are worth no more than that of a fly. You take it and swat it dead. Just like that.
I don't even know who we're fighting for over there, to be real honest with you. I think we're fighting for the North Vietnamese, ain't we?
Very early on, you started getting a sense of something was not right. Something was, you know, not what you were told that you were going to do.
Awful sick of it. I'll be so glad to go home. I don't know. It's the worst area we've been in since I've been in Vietnam.
You think it's worth it?
Yeah, I don't know. They say we're fighting for something. I don't know.
Every means we have to escalate, the enemy can match us, and that applies to invasion of the North, the use of nuclear weapons, or the mere commitment of 100 or 200 or 300,000 more American troops to the battle. And with each escalation, the world comes closer to the brink of cosmic disaster.
Vietnam in a game of chess was a small pawn on a chessboard, easily sacrificed, because you had to protect the kings and the queens, who were the big power players.
It was not within his realm of reckoning to either explain the war or to correct the wrong.
What about the contention that your attitude is sometimes arrogant, that you never admit you were wrong? Have you ever been wrong, sir?
I feel that during the trajectory of the war, once he was out of office in 1968, that he tried to explain to me his reasons for remaining in the position and taking the positions that he took out of loyalty to the presidents that he served, and that he felt his loyalty as a appointed Secretary of Defense was higher than his willingness to go outside of his role as Secretary of Defense and end the war that he realized was never a winnable war.
So this is sadly a war whose legacies just will not end. No president wanted to
be the first to lose a war for America.
So we had this idea that if we stopped the Secretary of Defense, we could stop the war. It was silly. It was naive. Even that resulted in riots. But by that time, the war was completely out of control.
At the start of 1968, 3 years after U.S. ground forces first landed in Vietnam, there are nearly 500,000 Americans in country.
One thing I've learned is you can't believe hardly anything of what the government or the mainstream media says. They are driven by an agenda, a reason, whether it's the military-industrial complex, the profit motive. So I do not rely on those. In fact, I tend to go in the opposite direction of what they do. I have to dig under the surface. That's what I've learned. You have to dig under the surface and not accept what they present as the facts.
Over many years, we have made a national pledge to help South Vietnam defend its independence. And I intend to keep that promise.
I assumed that President Johnson and the Congress knew a lot more than I did. There were reasons why we needed to be stopping the communists in Vietnam so they wouldn't be crawling the beaches of California, right?
So there was a threat, but Ho Chi Minh was not that threat. Ho Chi Minh wanted independence and freedom for his people. And I've seen NVA and VC generals interviewed, and they all talk about, yes, they were communists, but they were there fighting for freedom and unity.
Who could have ever imagined that 550,000 American troops, Agent Orange, bombing campaigns, Rolling Thunder, everything, and we were no closer to achieving our limited political objective. Why was that? It's because the Vietnamese had a rallying cry. What was their rallying cry? Get the Americans to go home. The Americans go home. This is our country, Vietnam, Vietnam self-determination, Vietnam for Vietnamese. And we never understood that.
If Indochina goes, several things happen right away. The Krop Peninsula, the last little bit of end hanging on down there would be scarcely defensible. The tin and the tungsten that we so greatly value from that area would cease coming.
We don't see the end of the tunnel, but I must say, I don't think it's darker than it was a year ago, in some ways lighter. Yes.
So we must be ready to fight in Vietnam, but the ultimate victory will depend upon the hearts and the minds of the people who actually live out there.
Throughout the war in Vietnam, the United States has exercised a degree of restraint unprecedented in the annals of war.
When the Second World War was over, we were the one great power in the world. We also began to feel the sense of a world power that possibly we could control the future of the world.
Vietnam was a civil war. And yes, we do need help. And if Americans would like to help, that at a time, all we ask is the training and the ammunition. And let us do the fighting. Because it's really hard to differentiate friend from foe when people are the same color, skin-wise, and they could be your neighbor. That is an impossible war, in a sense, to win.
Who are we to tell countries around the world that whatever they've chosen is the wrong path?
It was an unjust war. I didn't understand why we were there. And then when I dug into why we're there, then I realized, well, they're fighting for their own country, the Vietnamese are, like we did in the American Revolution.
We could have won a war if Americans commit 100%. We could have.
Back in the 1950s, 1960s, America was consumed with anti-communism, with the belief that you had to stop communism at every opportunity you have. This is the way most American politicians felt at the conclusion of World War II. It's really a shame because President Franklin Delano Roosevelt had been committed to ending colonization in Asia and in other parts of the world. But when he died and Harry Truman became the President of the United States, Truman rejected that imperative to end colonialism, and he supported French efforts to recolonize Vietnam.
I grew up with the Vietnam War, not even realizing that it was something to grow up with, but we all did. I distinctly remember a newscast that showed the news in the evening as the adults would gather around television sets.
This is a CBS News special report, The Ordeal of Con Tien.
And you'd look to see, in particular, they scrolled the body count or a list of wounded, and everybody was always looking for names.
274 American soldiers were killed in action. 1,320 were wounded, and 12 are missing.
The military can no longer justify this war with a casualty count. It may be that more Marines are dying along the DMZ than enemy.
At the same time, the news reports themselves were punctuated by riots and such. As a youngster, I couldn't understand fully why these people who were rioting were not helping. To my young mind at the time, I didn't understand that. I thought that that somehow was taking away from the effort.
This is what the war in Vietnam is all about. The old and the very young. The Marines have burned this old couple's cottage because fire was coming from here. Come this way.
It was unfeeling and it was brutal. And they immediately made this community of people scratching a living out of rice paddies into refugees.
The women and the old men who remained will never forget that August afternoon.
The media was not responsible for any failures of Vietnam policy, as some critics would like to suggest. As a matter of fact, the media was responsible for pointing out the contradictions in policy. Now, Vietnam changed the whole role of the media. Back then, unlike today, reporters could roam about the field. They could go anywhere they want.
You could literally call up a company commander, say a captain or a major, and say, anything planned, anything interesting? Sure, come on up, come on down. And you would, and you'd turn up that evening or the next morning early, and you'd go out on an operation that might produce nothing, or indeed would produce something that you maybe wish you hadn't turned up for.
Look at how many journalists were killed in Laos and Cambodia. Many were killed. Many have never been found. And indeed, the whole idea of embedding with units didn't exist back then. So reporters could go anywhere. And guess what? What were they doing? They were seeing a picture of a war and beaming it home to Americans and writing about it that was completely different than the optimistic scenarios given by General Westmoreland or President Johnson. Victory is just around the corner. We're almost at the crossover point. As a matter of fact, the media, I think, during the war, provided an indispensable service, which is very difficult to do today because of the tight controls that are placed on the media.
If the communist intention was to take and seize the cities, they came closer here at Hue than anywhere else. And now, 3 weeks after the offensive began, the firing still goes on from here on the new side of the city and across the Perfume River to the old side, the Citadel.
It turned out that President Johnson had been watching that broadcast. He watched all the three network evening broadcasts, I gather, and he said, flipping the set off with some anger, "If I've lost Cronkite, I've lost Middle America."
Eastern world, it is exploding, violence flaring, bullets loading.
You know, the Tet Offensive is a turning point. It is a significant event, but a lot sort of stays the same after the 1968 Tet Offensive. That, of course, we know that the war doesn't end after the ferocious fighting in 1968 and drags on for, you know, another 5 years for the Americans until 1973, and then another 7 years for the Vietnamese until 1975. And in many ways, the fighting after Tet was much more violent and, as I said, ferocious in the months after the Tet Lunar New Year throughout 1968, but you did have Vietnamization by 1969. You did have troop withdrawal beginning under the Richard M. Nixon administration.
I implemented a plan to train and equip the South Vietnamese to withdraw American forces and to end American involvement in the war just as soon as the South Vietnamese had developed the capacity to defend their country against communist aggression.
Nick Ut's photo, in many ways, changed people's perception of the war. We kept hearing reports of progress, but Nick's photo brought the dimension of human tragedy. The fact that we were using napalm and the effects of it to seeing the flesh of a young girl is one of the most powerful images of the war.
The fire burned off my clothes, and I saw my arm got burned with the fire.
When I seen that photo of the young girl running in the street, naked, burning with napalm on her, the feeling of pain and horror and shock that this could happen to a person, let alone a person that young, was too much.
When people are asked about their recollections of images of the war, that photograph and the photograph at the end of the execution of a Viet Cong prisoner are the two most memorable images from the war. The one thing that I've learned from studying the American war in Vietnam, or the Vietnam War, we don't even know what to call it really. It was really a war between the Vietnamese until the Americans got involved. Everything that came out of Washington always had an optimistic scenario. It was always cheery. It was always just, if one more turn and you were going to be bringing these troops home. But photographs like Nick's brought home the fact that this war was out of control. And I think that's the power of that image.
My picture tells the story. What Americans do in Vietnam, South Vietnam do in the war.
Vietnam's struggle goes on.
But it was far from Los Angeles, in Vietnam, where Ut began his career. After his older brother, who was also a photographer, was killed on assignment, Nick went to the Associated Press and begged for a job.
They said, too young, go home.
After much persistence, he was hired a year later at the age of 16. And for 10 years, Nick covered the Vietnam War, capturing so many haunting images.
My eye looked right by Gorda. I saw the girl running like this. I said, why the girl running in no clothes? I run right away in there. I keep shooting a picture of her. And she passed to me. I saw her skin coming off. The body is so burned so bad, she still smoke in her body. I say, I think she died soon. Then I have my poor camera. I put all my gear right in the highway one.
Recently, I had an opportunity to meet Nick Ut, who is the Pulitzer Prize-winning photographer who took the picture of the napalm girl. And it's an extraordinary picture. Many think that it helped end the war. And I had a chance to talk to Nick a bit about it. And he explained about not only taking the picture, but then taking off his jacket and covering the girl and seeing the girl got care. And 50 years later, he's still in contact with her. He talks to her on a weekly basis. And it's just an amazing relationship that they have, and that the picture is extraordinary, but I think him staying involved in this woman's life and seeing her through these 50 years is also quite extraordinary.
Good way actually to understand the role of the media is to take the horrific events that occurred at My Lai, where this was covered up by the government for one whole year.
Before we went into My Lai, we looked at it as a way of getting revenge for everybody that we had lost.
When I heard about the My Lai massacre, that, I mean, hundreds of Vietnamese civilians were just brutally murdered and worse, that just added to my outrage and just made me more determined to oppose the war and figure out what I could do to join others to try to stop it. And what was it about our society that made us get into that situation?
The big thing over there at the time was body count. And you just kept reading in the newspapers how many, you know, VC that we killed and that were counted. And holy cow, where are all these people coming from? And so I thought to myself, I'm always a curious person. I'm always an adventuresome type person. So I decided, you know, I'll see for myself.
March the 16th, 1968. Horror and barbarism swept through the village of My Lai in Vietnam.
Was not a conventional war where the enemy is right in front of you and you can easily identify them. It was just guerrilla warfare, and I don't think we were very well trained in how to fight a guerrilla warfare. Plus, we also did not understand the culture of the environment of the people. You know, the history of the people, or even a little bit about their language, what to expect.
I was the only one assigned to take the operation. There was no other photographer. There was myself, the photographer. There was a person named Jay Roberts, who was the writer. The two of us were sent on a mission together.
And if not for that story, who knows how long that cover-up would have existed. A war crime, a massacre, something that the United States was embarrassed in the eyes of the world. And if not for the media and two or three brave soldiers who came forward, we would have never known that story. And Ron Haberle, very brave, thorough journalist who was coming back and forth.
I volunteered to go on the operation because I only had maybe about a couple weeks left in country. I didn't have to go. So I volunteered, and I looked at my buddy that was with me, Jay Roberts, the reporter. I said, I'll go if you go. I said, okay, let's go. So we both, kind of volunteered for it. And so I had no inclination that what happened there happened. We were supposed to meet up with the 48th Viet Cong, the Remnants Battalion, and do battle with them. That was my understanding.
Before going down there, we were told that anybody down there would be considered VC or VC sympathizers, and as such would be dealt with as such, and we were on a search and destroy mission, and that everything from the housing, food, people were to be destroyed because that's what a search and destroy mission was.
First feeling I had was in the helicopter when the pilot came over the radio and said, the zone is hot, which means there's, battle going on. So Jay and I remember just looked at each other and said, what did we get ourselves into? So the choppers put down on the ground, we jumped out, and choppers took off. We heard a lot of gunfire. That's amazing. But yet there was no outcoming fire from the village toward us. Because you can tell, when you're being shot at, you can hear the bullets crack in the air and that. So there was nothing. So we stood up, and I was with assigned to the 3rd Platoon. We did not go into the village until about 9 o'clock that morning. And yet there was still a lot of firing going on in that. And we thought, something's going on in there. But I was a little scared. I kept looking around and just, wondering what the heck is going on. Couldn't quite figure it out at the time. And as we were going down toward Highway 521, I noticed a bunch of civilians, what they looked like to me, being guarded by some soldiers. So I figured, they're holding them for interrogation. So as we continued a little bit further on down, I heard some more rapid fire, gunfire. Looked to my left, and all of a sudden I see these group of people getting up trying to run. They're being shot at. And you can see distinctly that they were civilians. They weren't military. So right then and there, Jay and I started, something's not right. But we still had to continue with the 3rd Platoon down toward 521. And there were some people on the trail on 521, which they did look military age to me, in the black pajamas and that. But it's fairly, a good distance. And the soldiers just opened up on the people on 521 and, shot at them. And one of my photographs shows, which looks like three bodies on the trail being military-aged males.
I just lost all sense of direction, of purpose. I just started killing any kind of way I could kill.
What happened back in 1969, of August, I think it was around the 25th, the CID contacted me and wanted to question me about, My Lai, because the lead investigator, to me, he was great. He was very understanding, and he was able to explain to me more what happened there that day that I didn't realize. In fact, he asked me, "Did you see any mutilations or any rapes?" I said, "No, I didn't, see anything like that." I said, "Did they happen?" He said, "Yes." Then he started to explain what happened in Binh Tay, especially after the rapes of young women, teenagers, and after they were raped, they were shot. There were 22 rapes there that day on that operation. And none of them, from my understanding, survived. And that disgusted me at the time. And that was my major decision to go ahead and release these photographs to the public when I heard about that.
And when these guys first started raping a girl, you know, these just young girls, some of them are 15, 16 years old, you know, and some down as low as 13 and maybe even 12. I'd go up to a guy because I'm bigger than him, you know, and I'd grab him and say, "You leave that girl alone." I had about five guys come to me, and they says, "Look, Bunning," everybody goes by last name, says, "Look, Bunning, you leave us alone and we're going to kill you."
I decided, you know, I'm going to go ahead and I got to destroy these. You know, I can't show this. This was in my own mind because here I'm going to show maybe one or two guys, three or four guys who are doing the shooting. And there's, look at the rest of the soldiers that were involved in this. Why should I go ahead and do this and ruin especially their lives? And that was my understanding, because in my mind, we're all guilty.
How can you forgive? You know, I can't forgive myself for the things, even though I know it was something that I did and something that I was told to do. But how can I forgive that? I forgive. I can't. I live with it every day.
Once the, you know, photographs were published in that, I started receiving questions from a lot of people about Lieutenant Callie. Did you see him there that day? No, I did not see him there that day. If you did, you sure? Everybody has thought, I was with Callie. If not, I was with the 1st Platoon or the 2nd Platoon, but I was with the 3rd Platoon. Why didn't you try to stop him? Why don't you, I didn't see him. You know, we went back and forth on that all the time. So it's not, to me, it's not all about Callie. It's about all of us. We're all guilty for some reason there that day. We all had a part in the operation. Me, I'm guilty of a cover-up.
I was of age in my teens. There was no way I could have made a moral decision. You know, I volunteered to go to Vietnam. And if somebody had come up to me and said, "Please don't do this. This is an evil thing," it would have been white noise. I was there for a year and a half. You know, extended for another 6 months. Still no clue as to what I was taking part in.
I came back to Vietnam from 1992, my first time since the war. I was overcome by many emotions, anger, guilt, remorse, and I felt that I needed to do something more for the Vietnamese people. So I came to My Lai, and I gave an offering of music to the spirits of the dead. Of the dead Vietnamese people and the dead American people.
By that time in my life, My Lai had come to symbolize the whole war. You know, the whole war is atrocity. So when we got there, I got my fiddle out and I played taps. Now, it's a military tune, an American military tune, but to me it's always meant farewell and rest in peace. And it was tough. Everybody was crying, including me, and my hands were shaking so much I had the vibrato I've never had since. I still don't really know why it affects the people of Vietnam so strongly, but it does. I thought to be respectful that, you know, I would face the statues in about three times.
The truth is something that really should be told. And with these photographs, I believe I can tell the truth what happened there that day, which I participated in. I can't tell what happened, you know, in the areas I wasn't in, but I can tell what I witnessed. Let people make up their own mind. War is war. War will always be war. There's always things that are going to happen to civilians. The civilians are like caught in a catch-22, especially in Vietnam. You have the Americans, the South Vietnamese in the daytime, trying to tell them what to do. You have the Viet Cong coming in at night telling them what to do. All they want to do is take care of their families, grow their rice. They want to live in peace. They don't want to put up with all this going around them. Myself, I live a positive life. I don't dwell on the past. I don't sit there in a bar drinking, telling war stories and stuff like that. No, I don't do that. I'm always willing to tell my story to anybody that, you know, willing to listen. There are a lot of reactions. People, I'll forget one person mentioned on this radio show of me doing this all in Hollywood. This was all made up. Couldn't happen. People didn't believe it. They didn't want to believe it. Yeah. No, I believed it because I was there. It did happen. It should not have happened. Everything, you know, everything went wrong that day, completely wrong.
When you know that the bad guy's the bad guy and that's the bad guy, but it's different when you go into one of these villages or you go into one of these towns and there's children and there's women, or you're out and there's a caravan in the desert and you don't know who's who.
The report was like there's calmness in the village when they were not, or maybe the communists already left. We don't know, but there is some type of confusion, and the village got punished. And you, because I guess the soldier came in and they said, oh, everybody in black and communist. Not true, because people wear black.
The bottom line to any soldier who served or any serviceman who served was to protect this country against all enemies, foreign and domestic, and they didn't specify who that enemy might be.
Here's a poem by W.D. Earhart, a Marine combat veteran. It's called Making the Children Behave. Do they think of me now in those strange Asian villages where nothing ever seemed quite human but myself and my few grim friends moving through them, hunched in lines? When they tell stories to their children of the evil that awaits misbehavior, is it me they conjure? Protest. Regarding the latest bombing that destroyed a friendly village, here is my medal for good conduct, for yet another operation that devastated so many lives. Here are my campaign ribbons. If that is not enough, I'll protest until my death this murderous madness. When the veterans came back and attended protests, including at the U.S. Capitol building, they would throw their medals onto the steps of the Capitol building, the medals that they were awarded for being good, effective soldiers. They were embarrassed about that duty. They didn't want those medals, and they didn't want to be thanked for their service.
Vietnamese crossed the gallantry with Silver Star. Gallantry ground combat, 4 air medals, and I was there, Rivers.
I don't know what led up to it, but I went to my mother's house, went to the attic, got my uniform, medals, threw them in the garbage.
That's why it's important that we hear from them, not just from historians, but from the actual veterans themselves, who had been tricked, lied to, told that this was a patriotic thing to do, to go and fight this war. And when they were there, they realized that the patriotic thing to do was to oppose the war.
What I learned about the Vietnamese is they're willing to forgive, but they never will forget. The United States is trying to bury the history of this war. It was a bad war. I'll say, well, we lost the war. We didn't win this war. No, no. People, they want everyone to forget about Vietnam.
I was very aware of the animosity towards the Vietnam War. My father always felt as though we should never have gone into Vietnam. And so I, as a young person, I carried that bias with me. I knew that this was really a tragic war. And more so as life went on, especially when I got to see wounded soldiers airvac from Vietnam to Clark Air Base into the hospitals there.
when I heard about the Kent State shootings, I was obviously outraged. I mean, I joined demonstrations. There were demonstrations all over the country. 300 college campuses were shut down. I participated in that. I did a film about the Kent State shootings titled Kent State, The Day the War Came Home. That really radicalized me as much as anything, when shooting our own students who were righteously demonstrating against an unjust war. Some of the kids who got shot weren't even participating in a protest. They were just walking across the campus. So that just shows how crazy it was.
1968 witnessed a lot of, you know, brutal massacres on the part of American soldiers. We all know about My Lai. There were also massacres carried out by Korean soldiers. And if you look at in-country, beyond Kent State, you had Jackson State. We know much more about Kent State, of course, Jackson State being predominantly black, student body, university, that you hear less of what happened in Jackson State. And so there's definitely, you know, all human lives don't matter equally.
I always remark to people that the most amazing thing about the Vietnamese, they have forgiven us for what our intervention did. And for that, I'm forever grateful. The case of Agent Orange is we weaponized a chemical, and we used it to create chemical warfare in Vietnam. And the consequences of that are living in third and fourth generation of Vietnamese, but also third and fourth generation of the offspring of the Americans who served in Vietnam. And we don't even know when that will end. And what makes the tragedy even greater is the lack of attention, the lack of making it a priority for so many years by the United States government to compensate both the Vietnam veterans and their children are still not getting compensated, and the grandchildren are not getting compensated. But of course, the cost in Vietnam.
When I first started going back to Vietnam, one of the things that my relatives who remained in the country after 1975, what they would say is, don't eat vegetables from here. These farmlands were ruined. You'll see this in the villagers who live there. It is very tragic. It is very, this is terrible. How could humans have done this to one another? That this war that took place and you know, wiped out millions in one generation, how could it keep going? How could it keep being this sort of reminder? Was something that my relatives in country would always talk about. They would try to steal me and brace me for what I would see, you know, in these areas devastated by Agent Orange and dioxin.
During the Vietnam War, Americans were told that spraying millions of acres of dense jungle with Agent Orange would deprive the Viet Cong of cover and save GIs' lives. But in the decades since, the herbicide's use in Vietnam has been blamed for creating a human catastrophe among veterans.
I died in Vietnam and didn't even know it.
And the Vietnamese.
With Agent Orange, you have to wonder, at the time, were these hazardous, caustic effects known to that chemical agent? Was it known to the company? And if it was, you know, we had people using it, and what kind of protective gear? To believe that even children born afterwards to parents who were exposed to that, you know, is mind-boggling. And I'd hate to think that these people, the military people doing their job, because it was a defoliant, were being used as guinea pigs for something that science knew was hazardous.
So when my father got over there, he realized that Agent Orange was available. He had his staff check with the chemical companies and was assured by them that there were no harmful consequences. He would find out years later that that was a lie, and that the chemical companies knew from private doctors that a lot of farmers were suffering the effects because the equivalent of Agent Orange was used to clear farmland and so forth. Because my father saw that if you were serving on a swift boat in these narrow waterways, you stood a 72% chance of being killed or wounded during a one-year tour over there, he and being assured that there were no harmful effects with Agent Orange, he decided to use it. And the casualty rate dropped from 72% to 6%. So from a military standpoint, it was a smart decision to use it. What he didn't realize is that years later, those people that were exposed to it would be fighting for their lives. And even some of the ships, in fact, the ship I was on was one of those that was identified because we were close enough to shore where we were sucking in the seawater and processing it for use on board ship. So those ships that were operating close to shore like that were designated as being within the area affected by Agent Orange.
First time I remember being exposed to Agent Orange was in Da Nang Harbor. We were there and we were loading, and I didn't realize that, that at the time, you're out, you're there, it looked like rain. And I'm thinking, what in the world is all this? The Da Nang Airport is where they loaded all of this onto the C-121s to go out. But as they had to come back in, then they could not land with any of that on board. So then they had to begin to empty it out as they came into the airfield. Then they were dumping it right into the harbor where we were. And they had just taken out only God knows how much that they had sprayed over the forest out, and near the rivers. And so they had to empty it out. When they did, then of course we were exposed to it. No matter how hard you try, there was no way to get the carcinogens out of the water. And we're in the water. We were being constantly exposed to it the whole time that we were there. Like I said, they could distill the water, do everything they wanted to do. It didn't matter. It was still in the water. So you drank it, you bathed in it, you were in it when you were on the landing craft that we were on, and it's splashing all over you. They said, nothing to worry about. It didn't hurt you then. It's not going to hurt you now. I said, okay. That's okay. Well, I understand. You've told me that. I believe it.
He knew the from his own days in World War II, he knew the sacrifices that young men were making. There was no way he could abandon them. So even though politically he was against the war, he was the kind of a leader that just simply would not do that to his men. Elmo did wrestle with the morality of it, and had a tough time honoring those who went as himself and volunteered to go, and those that did not. However, he too came to the realization, because of the humanity in him, that everyone kind of has to make their own destiny and make their own decisions about their lives. And so he never had a inner bitterness about other people's decisions. He just felt as though those of us that have volunteered honor us as well. When Elmo was diagnosed with cancer, in the beginning, all of us felt as though Elmo was going to beat it. He knew that there were scientists and physicians who analyzed Agent Orange. Coming from being the son of two physicians, he couldn't imagine that people would do that and come up with kind of a faulty analysis of what Agent Orange can do. Dad has often said that if he had to make that decision again to spray Agent Orange, that he would. The casualty rate was 6% every month. So that meant in 1 year, a sailor had a 70-75 chance of dying in Vietnam in that year. So what he did saved many more lives ultimately. He knows the outcome of that tragic decision that he made.
When it was first conceived, the idea was you would use these chemicals to deprive the Viet Cong of food. That would be the first thing. But then it went from food to more of a defensive military use. And who wanted to use it more than anyone? President Diem of South Vietnam. Our man in Vietnam, who we had helped construct the whole government of South Vietnam. But they were protected by what was called the manufacturer's liability defense, which was they supplied the government with what they had requested. But the only problem is that they had not disclosed and there's a reason that it wasn't disclosed. It was going to be used on the enemy. It wasn't going to be used on Americans, right? So they thought of the Vietnamese like the mice they were testing or the rats they were testing in laboratories.
What did Vietnam look like?
What did Vietnam look like? Well, if it wasn't for the people, it was very pretty. The people over there are very backward and very primitive, and they just make a mess out of everything.
They weren't Americans, so if some Vietnamese got sick from this stuff, big deal. We're fighting a war. They're the enemy. The irony of that, and the tragic irony, of course, is that it degraded not only the lives of the Vietnamese and who they were as people, but it was wrong because it affected U.S. servicemen as well.
I think my father had a firewall that he just would not ever take down. And I don't know why. Was he trying to protect me? Because in doing so, he hurt me. He hurt us. He hurt our nation, and he hurt the Vietnamese. And at this point in my life, I wonder not only why couldn't he apologize to the families, the mothers, the fathers, the sons, the daughters who lost their loved ones in Vietnam, let alone the millions of Vietnamese who were lost. But an apology, I don't believe, is enough. An apology of saying I was wrong, which my father did eventually say, an apology of saying I'm sorry is important. However, what the Vietnamese need and what we need, the men who fought in Vietnam, are reparations for the issues that we spoke about in terms of Agent Orange and the munitions that have been, the bombs that have been dropped on Vietnam that today are still exploding when farmers go out to till their fields.
It's a very, very tragic story. And one of the great things I think that's going on in Vietnam right now are the number of Vietnam veterans, Americans, who have moved back to Vietnam, particularly in the Da Nang area, and are dedicating their lives to working with the Vietnamese to try, with respect to two areas in particular. Number one would be chemicals, Agent Orange, and number two, which would be the remaining unexploded ordnances. Both cases, I think, some of the best testament for what we're trying to do.
I'm Chuck Searcy. I'm from Athens, Georgia. When I came to Vietnam in 1967, I couldn't find Vietnam on a map. Came here because I'm a veteran of the war, and ended up staying, working on humanitarian projects related to the consequences of the war, which is unexploded ordnance.
More than 100,000 Vietnamese have been killed or maimed by unexploded ordnance, called UXOs, since the end of the war in 1975. Here in Quang Tri province, bordering the DMZ, the former demilitarized zone that once separated South and North Vietnam, more bombs are believed to have been dropped than in all of Europe during World War II. Many of them were cluster bombs, containing hundreds of these small but very lethal bomblets that were supposed to have exploded on impact.
The Defense Department estimates that about 10% did not detonate as designed. So when they fell to the ground intact, now today, 40 years later, they're exploding and they kill and maim people. For me, Vietnam was an unclosed chapter in the sense that when I left, it was a painful experience. And it's one of the reasons that I hoped that I would come back and in better circumstances, because that was a terrible state in which to leave things.
This unexploded bomb was spotted by a farmer at the edge of his rice paddy, less than 30 yards from his home and where his children played. Having attended one of Searcy's bomb education classes, not only did the farmer know what it was, he knew how to call one of Searcy's more than 20 bomb removal teams, trained to safely blow it up in place rather than risk trying to remove it. Before leaving, the bomb squad found two more UXOs in the farmer's field.
The seriousness of the unexploded ordnance situation in Vietnam is beyond what most Americans could imagine. We dropped about 15 million tons of ordnance in this part of the world, and in Quang Tri province, which is the most heavily bombed area in the history of warfare, the province was virtually destroyed. There was hardly a tree left standing when the war was over.
Project Renew is what Searcy calls his education and bomb removal operation. Bui Trong Hong, a former North Vietnamese Army colonel and explosives expert, is Circe's chief tactical officer. Adversaries during the war, they now work together as allies.
After the war ended, I came back to my school and then I became an engineering officer.
The real challenge in Vietnam is not how to clean up every bomb and mine, but how to make Vietnam safe. But that does not mean that every bomb and mine needs to be cleaned up. It means that people have to understand the problem. They have to be part of the process of solving the problem, which is to know how to call in explosive ordnance disposal teams that will come immediately and clean up the ordnance that they found.
In addition to their bomb disposal teams, Project Renew has set up educational programs for preventing accidents, along with prosthetic services and occupational programs for the unfortunate victims of UXOs.
The management of the problem will have to be continued for a long time to come. But nobody should be killed, nobody should have an accident, should be injured, lose an eye or an arm or a leg in the future.
The military expression, clean up your brass after firing your weapons, is something both Secretary of State John Kerry and Secretary of Defense Chuck Hagel are familiar with as Vietnam veterans themselves.
I think the most appropriate, the most meaningful commemoration of the war for us Americans would be to come together to help Vietnam make this country safe from cluster munitions and other ordnance like this. Could be achieved, we could have full closure.
It was interesting when we went over there in 1994 for the first time. You had a situation where the U.S. government at that point in time did not recognize any correlation between exposure to Agent Orange and various cancers and other maladies, as opposed to the Vietnamese government, which everything was related to Agent Orange exposure. You had the two extremes, and as usual, the truth is somewhere in the middle.
Within Vietnam, August 10th has been designated the day to mourn and to remember those who are victims of Agent Orange and continue to be victims of Agent Orange. And so this is an issue that, just is something that is very important to all those who are still alive. The responsibility of the United States, also of Vietnam too, to, address these victims who continue to this day to suffer from wounds of war.
The U.S. government began cleaning up the first Agent Orange hotspot at the Da Nang Airport.
To actually see that the two governments are taking steps to tangibly destroy this terribly dangerous poison was very significant.
When my father threw himself into the Agent Orange issue, here's somebody with no medical background who was able to take a number of these medical studies that had been done and to show how they had been flawed. For example, the veterans who had served more than one tour in Vietnam for some reason were excluded. But, it's more likely than not that if you had another tour over there, you were more exposed to it or had a better chance of being exposed to it than if you just had the one tour. They also were only looking at battalion size units and larger. And, it was the company size units that were on the periphery of the fire bases setting up security that were really exposed to the agent more so than everybody else. The other thing my father discovered is that the VA had set up a medical board, and every 3 years they would review the evidence to see whether or not there was a correlation. And every 3 years they had ruled there's no correlation. Well, my father found out that many of the doctors on that board worked for the chemical companies that had manufactured Agent Orange. And so he recommended that it be disbanded and totally independent doctors be put on the board. And the first meeting that independent board had, my father had come up with a list, as I recall, of about 25 cancers and other things that were caused. The board initially approved three of those. But every 3 years, they've been reevaluating, and I think now they're up to at least 16 or 17. It had been my father's hope that he would live long enough to see all the cancers recognized. But I thought that was quite a feat for somebody who had no medical background to identify that there was a correlation, and now the medical community is coming in that direction.
I fought the VA for
4 years for benefits, and it seems every time that I go there, there's some type of a problem at the VA. And I find it rather ironic, being a 100% disabled veteran, that I get the free health care, but I have to go to the VA hospital. My wife doesn't. She can go to any hospital or doctor, and the VA pays for it. What's the matter with that picture?
Out of the visits we've had, overwhelmingly, 70% of them are Vietnam veterans. I think that, and I'm not political, because I believe that if you're in the armed forces, that whoever the commander in chief is who you should abide by. But I will tell you that I think that there was poor planning for that mission. And because of the poor planning, we wound up with the end results that we had of people coming back heavily addicted to drugs, mentally unstable, can't find their footing, can't get compensation, don't know how. But I'm going to blame that on poor planning. And no other mission since then has been planned that way.
I did feel quite a bit of resentment, and that's where I started changing my view on the war and the enemy we fought there.
For me, I can think of no other sort of greater calling than to try to help, you know, sort of my countrymen or my people, if that's the global diaspora, but also my country of birth and the people there to, you know, to heal these wounds of war and to reconcile fully. I think that's, you know, something that probably I will not see in my lifetime, but I definitely see progress being made.
You just can't go there as an American without feeling a tremendous sense of guilt, I think. I felt a tremendous sense of guilt and responsibility, even though it's a collective sense. And then the helplessness with which you know that you can't help these people in any way, except by perhaps contributing some money so that they can have the care that they need. But the legacy of our spring in Vietnam lives today. The Vietnamese are relentless in their quest for accountability.
It is the responsibility of the United States, also of Vietnam too, to, you know, address these victims who continue to this day to suffer from wounds of war.
They don't have anything. They don't have any money to have radiation therapy, chemotherapy, and all that, or surgery to remove. They just have enough money to live day by day and to pay for injection to relieve the pain.
No one cared about the Vietnamese people at the moment of intervention. So for me, the escalation of the war in 1965 is the single most tragic decision, because we had a chance to get out, right? We had a chance not to escalate the war. In 1965, there were only 125,000 American troops in Vietnam. Very few in combat roles, limited combat roles. Lots of room to maneuver at that time. But it didn't happen. And it didn't happen because of our complete lack of understanding of who we were fighting and the history.
It took acts of Congress, and it took men dying, and it took veterans actually having to devote their entire livelihood to just making someone realize that they're not crazy, that this is really happening to them. If I went to Vietnam and then here, you know, 60 years later, I'd get colon cancer or lymph cancer, then I have to prove that it was caused by here, when in actuality we know that those are secondaries to this incident. There are things that they're entitled to that no one is telling them.
We know now about the effects of Agent Orange on our American soldiers, and we're finally coming around to helping them and helping them find a better life and giving them what they need. But have we even thought of the Vietnamese or that six-year-old boy that I saw in the park in Hanoi? And to think that his grandparents might have suffered from it and he may be suffering from it, and it's something that is out of the realm of even Americans thinking about. I didn't until this trip and until talking to Larry Berman about this, of the effects of Agent Orange.
I do think it is very important to keep learning about Vietnam, because Vietnam, for the, you know, sort of American consciousness will always stand in as what happens when the United States and Americans get involved in a war that is not their own, and what devastation could come out of that. And so it's a warning. If it's true that history doesn't repeat itself, but you can hear its echoes, I think by understanding what happened in Vietnam and the war, we can prevent those echoes from continuing in subsequent generations.
In many ways, we've learned very little. The reason is because we really haven't reflected very much on what are the lessons of Vietnam with respect to interventions in areas on the other side of the globe. People use the term counterinsurgency, for example, right? It has a completely different meaning in Vietnam as it did in Iraq and Afghanistan. But in terms of things I'm interested in, so take the issue of Agent Orange, right? When we intervened, did Saddam Hussein have chemical weapons or not? That was the really big issue. But did anyone really begin to think about the issue of, well, if he did, how are we going to deal with that in terms of our troops with respect and where they're stored compared to the Agent Orange canisters in Vietnam?
Vietnam to me is a special country. Like, in my own mind, everybody says, welcome home, welcome home. Well, I'm sorry, but I really didn't leave Vietnam. Part of me is still in Vietnam. It'll always be in Vietnam. It's a beautiful country, a lot of great people. I've met many, many people there. They're very, super friendly in that. Fantastic people. It's hard to believe there's been a war there, but what I learned about the Vietnamese is they're willing to forgive, but they never will forget. The United States is trying to bury the history of this war. It was a bad war. I'll say, well, we lost the war. We didn't win this war. No. People, they want everyone to forget about Vietnam. And now the relationship between the U.S. and Vietnam is on, really super positive side. And they want to keep that memory to the background.
So I think that this is a living legacy. And though it may not prevent future wars, we're hoping that it inspires soldiers to realize that they have the inner strength to stand up against an unjust war.
The war that's ended is the war between America and Vietnam, but the war that continues in many ways is the war between the Vietnamese. That is another sad saga of the whole story of Vietnam, which is the hundreds of thousands of Vietnam refugees who live in California, in Virginia, and in Texas, who are today American citizens, a vital part of the American dream, but many of whom can never go home again to their homeland, where they were born, where their ancestors are. And they are still fighting that war. And for me, true reconciliation will come. The Vietnamese in this country and the Vietnamese in Vietnam can reach some sort of peace and harmony with each other.
One of the things that always struck me in teaching about U.S. East Asian relations and being a scholar of the Vietnam War is that, the Vietnam War was in many, many ways hundreds of years in the making in terms of U.S. interaction with the countries of East Asia, the peoples of East Asia. You can see, in our own immigration policies that Asians were not considered, they were not considered equal. We hear all the time about the recent spike in anti-Asian hate, but there's a long, long history to that.
A lot of these soldiers don't want to remember those times. They don't want to dredge up those memories. They want to just get on with their lives.
A lot of blood was shed. They acknowledged 58,000 men died in Vietnam. It was more than that, and I know it was. And of course they know it was, but at least they acknowledged the 58,000 that they put on the wall. And it just was bloodshed for absolutely no purpose whatsoever. And then we left Vietnam without a victory, okay? So why were we there in the first place? Should have never have been there.
I ended up from May of 69 to March of 71 confined to the hospital. I ended up with 33 operations over that time frame. To date, I've survived 65 surgeries totally since May of 69. I've spent 2.5 years of my life in a bed recovering from that. But every day is a great day to be alive. Now, the first words out of my mouth when I wake up in the morning, thank you, God, for another day to be alive. It's a very precious gift.
I'm always proud of the fact that I'm a Vietnam veteran. I wear my hats. I'm not ashamed of what I did, you know. Proud of it. I really am. But I just know that people just don't care. And that's what I found out. People just didn't care whether you were a veteran or not, you know.
The mission of the Defense POWMA Accounting Agency is to account for Americans that are still unaccounted for from our past conflicts from World War II to present day. So when we look at those numbers, there's just under 82,000 Americans that are still unaccounted for. My role in outreach and communication is to work with families, veterans organizations, and in members of Congress to get our story out and to be here and provide answers to family members who have questions about their loved one.
I think the joint team of our DPA, military and civilian personnel, coupled with all of our VNO, our Vietnamese partners, is absolutely critical to doing this mission. We could not do it without it being a team effort.
Just the sheer scale of the operation that's going on. It's the military alongside the local workers and how it just eventually gets a real flow going, and you don't always need to know the same language in order to get work done.
I would hope we've learned something from Vietnam. I've hopefully learned quite a bit about putting soldiers in harm's way and then not allowing the military to actually conduct the operations the way they see fit. There's a lot of politics going on with the Vietnam War. And did we make some serious mistakes? Absolutely. You know, we were saying all along, no, we don't have any people in Laos, we don't have any people in Cambodia. And we were telling families that. And then when we told the families that they lost their loved one, that, well, he was in Laos, but you can't say anything. Hopefully we've learned a lesson that, look, these family members deserve the truth. And hopefully, if nothing else, we've learned that lesson, you know, to be truthful with the family members.
Getting excited and passionate about trying to achieve the mission and being dedicated and not wanting to quit without finding the person they're looking for and getting them home. That makes me feel very proud, very honored, and very appreciative.
People talk about it was a bad time for everybody, their side, our side, and now this is the one thing we can do, hopefully, I hope, to try and make it a win.
I think the power and the story of Vietnam, I think the story is that the incredible creativity and energy that the Vietnamese people have, the industrialness that they have, these are all things we can learn from them. And a lot of it has to do in the deep role of Buddhism in the country, and in a belief in another life, and in a belief in the tranquility of the present. And I find all that to be very, 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 very peaceful.
I see many similarities to actions that our country has taken around the world. In the film that Errol Morris did such an amazing job of filming, The Fog of War, my father and Errol developed 11 lessons. And one of those lessons was to empathize with your enemy. And that probably is the most difficult thing for us to do. And it must be the most difficult thing for leaders, secretaries of defense, presidents, and military personnel to do. And yet it is so critical. Had we done that in Vietnam, I think my father and the presidents he served would have been able to see the internal struggle that Vietnam was facing.
I wonder how much of a sort of mark Afghanistan will make on the American consciousness again. Vietnam, because there was a draft, because it had affected so many Americans, because we saw American boys coming back in coffins. One cannot see them, you know, now as Americans still get involved in overseas wars. I think they learned, the government learned those lessons. And so there are ways that they will ensure that we don't have another Vietnam, that there won't be a draft, that you're not gonna see American boys coming back in body bags. That's why it falls upon historians, documentary filmmakers to continue to say this is what happened in Vietnam.
I think it's something like only 1% now of people in this country have a connection to that war with a soldier, sailor, marine, airman, and so they're disconnected from it.
Older people maybe remember Vietnam, thinks it's the same thing as Afghanistan. A lot of people in this country, a lot of younger people don't like what happened in Afghanistan.
The Soviet Union destabilized the countryside that you had such lawlessness that by the end, you know, the Afghani people could look to the Taliban as, yes, bring back security, bring back peace and stability, that these outsiders had just basically destroyed any semblance of normal life for so long that this really is the rise of the Taliban in the countryside. And likewise, the same thing with the Vietnamese, that, you know, after the French come the Americans, there was just no peace, no stability.
Why do we keep going into first Vietnam, then Iraq, then Afghanistan and other countries in the meantime? Ultimately, the reasons for these wars are a profit-driven system, rather than a people-oriented system.
As far as I'm concerned today, I have no hesitancy whatsoever in saying I could not have been more wrong in my attitude toward Vietnam.
I think he took to his grave Vietnam. And that's where I feel an apology is actually not enough. I feel that he owed more to us and to the families that lost loved ones across the world.
Yes, I think we learned something from Vietnam. You know, we learned that the price of war is really high. The cost of human life is high.
The Vietnamese saying that we will always forgive, but we will never forget, haunts me because I do believe it. And I think that I can share that with my father. I can forgive, but I can never forget the decisions that you made.
As many of you know, I am the first vice president to visit Vietnam since diplomatic relations were established in 1995. And I believe that this trip signals the beginning of the next chapter in the relationship between the United States and Vietnam.
It's so amazing for us to think of what our legacy is today in Vietnam. I've had an opportunity to travel to Vietnam and found the Vietnamese people to be the most genuine, kind, forgiving people that I've ever experienced in my life. And yet our legacy of the American War, of the Vietnam War, continues. The deaths that are occurring in Vietnam from exposure to Agent Orange, those deaths that are occurring from ordnance that's still exploding in the fields, and those deaths that are occurring here from the men who fought in Vietnam are continuing on. And they are haunting us and their families and continue to bring sadness to this endeavor that was over 50 years ago.
I think back of all the soldiers that have died to give us the freedom. The cost of freedom is high. And, you know, and I hope our children, grandchildren realize that.
Through the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, and early 2000s, many people, when they would hear my name, McNamara, and my first name is Robert, would ask me, am I related to Robert McNamara? And what I found is honesty is the best response to that. Yes, I am his son. And yet I am my own person. And I've been able to, throughout my adult life, explore the differences between myself and my father. And that has given me the ability to write honestly about my relationship with my father and to accept the fact that he was a marvelous father in many ways. and that his embrace of nature and the exposure that he has given me to wilderness and the love and appreciation that we shared together is something that will never be taken away from me. And I can honestly say that the other part of our relationship, the unspoken one that involves his decisions about Vietnam, will never be repaired. And I can never take those back for him or for myself. I wish that for his wellness, in his passing, when he died in 2009, I wish that he had been able to forgive himself and forgive others for his mistakes. I think he would have passed in a much more peaceful way.
Recently, I got a phone call from a gentleman that I didn't know, and he explained that he was a Vietnamese gentleman who came to the United States in 1975 with his parents after the war. And he's lived here ever since. He's become an American citizen. And he looked me up, tracked me down. He saw Return to Vietnam. He was very touched by it, and he wanted to reach out to me. And after months and months, he found me. And he placed this call and told me that the only thing he wanted to do was to thank me for my service in Vietnam.
Learning about the character of the people of Vietnam and knowing this is beyond me. These are people who are beyond me. I'm not ever going to be that strong or that mature. It's the avenue which helps me on this road to, you know, moral balance. That's something I can't really articulate because it's deep inside me, almost like the core of myself, that I need Vietnam.